Last time on the Skip and Josh podcast.
I'm sure you remember the game, I don't know what year it was, where Gerald Henderson elbowed Tyler Hansbro and Hansbro was bleeding profusely.
I love that. I love that. Hansbro was such a dirty little rat. He deserved everything he got.
You're listening to the Skip and Josh podcast with Skip Sherman and Josh Obadia.
Okay, Skip, so today's topic is favorite Pearl Jam songs, which I think our listeners are really going to enjoy, especially because I know you're going to include some music clips in this episode, which I always like that. But before we get to that, I have to ask you, we talked about this a couple of months ago off air. Have you watched the new 30 for 30 series, Once Upon a Time in Queens?
I have not. I have not. I know we talked about it. I told you I was going to watch it. They're hard to find, the 30 for 30s. You got to catch them at the right time. You got to search your PVR, your guide, find out when it's on. It's a little bit involved, you know?
So I don't know what it's like with Videotron, because that's what you subscribe to. But if you have Bell and you subscribe to TSN, then you can get all the 30 for 30s on demand anytime you want.
Oh, then I could get them. So I'd have to watch online, though.
But that's with Bell. I don't know if it is like that with Videotron.
No, same thing. I'm sure it's the same thing. So how many episodes are there of this show? Four?
Yeah, there's four episodes. And
it's all about the 86 Mets, or it's like the whole history of the Mets up till then, or a little bit of both?
It's a little bit of both. It's not the entire history, and it's mostly focused on 86, of course, but there's other stuff as well. So anyway, I don't really want to talk about it until you watch it, because I have a lot of comments. I need you to watch it first, so I'm giving you homework.
Okay, I'm going to watch it. Maybe I'll watch it today. Maybe I'll watch it today.
That's fine. That's fine. You let me know whenever you watch it, and then we'll do a whole full review of it, because there's a lot of things I have to talk about. And I'm not even a Mets fan.
No, I'm not a Mets fan at all.
But of course, we know everything that happened because, well, they won the World Series on a crazy play that no one will ever forget. That's number one. Yeah. Number two, a big part of their World Series was the trade that sent Montreal icon Gary Carter to the New York Mets, which obviously broke our hearts. So it was a bit of a bittersweet thing to watch. Anyway, I've already said too much.
Okay, I'm going to watch. I'm going to watch for sure. I had two little things I wanted to say at the start, and then maybe I can do some listener mail. Very, very short things.
Great. Go ahead.
First of all, happy podcast anniversary. It's the fifth anniversary of the podcast.
Thanks. I didn't even know. Look how clueless I am. I didn't even know. Thank you very much. Happy anniversary to you too.
Here's the five more. And I want to congratulate the Atlanta Braves on winning the World Series. I know that pains you to say, and you're... The listeners watching the live stream can see Josh rolling his eyes and shaking his head. But, I mean, they deserved it. They had a great, great playoff. They had a great last month of the season and a great playoff. And they're the World Series champions. So, there you go.
So, since you brought it up, I'm going to say that this was the least interesting World Series possibly of all time.
Well, I mean, for you, yeah. But, I mean, friend Mike, who lives in Atlanta, this was huge for him, right? So...
Okay, if you're a fan of one of the teams, obviously it was interesting for you, but I haven't had my favorite team play in the World Series ever. And yet, I still watch the World Series every year, and I find it usually interesting. For example, think back to, what was it, 5 years ago when Chicago played Cleveland and went seven games? That was a crazy, exciting World Series, and I didn't care about either of those teams. So,
I get you. And it's too bad because the playoffs were great. And then I followed the playoffs religiously this year, right up till the end. And then when I got to the World Series, I was sort of just following it like on the periphery. You know, like I was like, oh, the Braves won today. Oh, the Astros came back. Oh, okay, the Braves won. You know, like I watched a little bit, but I didn't watch it like with as much attention as I had the previous series, you know?
Right. Of the six games, I think I might have watched a total of nine innings. Maybe.
Right. Right.
And this is what I did intentionally. I was watching the last game, and when there were two outs in the ninth inning, I turned off the television because I did not want to see the third out and I did not want to see the celebration. So I turned it off. So as far as I'm concerned, I don't even know who won.
There's a great video going around. I saw it yesterday. It's on Twitter. I'll share it with everybody. I think it's SportsCenter that put it together. It's like a 4 minute video. And it's the last out of every World Series for the last 50 years.
That is pretty cool, actually.
No, I shouldn't say the last out, the last play, right? Because it's not it's amazingly out of the last 50, I think there's only like four that didn't end on an out, believe it or not.
Right. Well, right? Some end on walk-offs.
Well, I mean, yeah, like there's the Joe Carter, Luis Gonzalez for the Diamondbacks, Edgar Renteria, the Marlins the first time they won, and I'm forgetting another one, but like those plays, right? So otherwise, they're mostly closers on the mound, you know? So, but it's still fun to watch. It's still fun to watch.
By the way, going back to Once Upon a Time in Queens, watching that reminded me, not that I needed reminding, how much better baseball used to be back then. Because both Boston and New York in the World Series were great teams. Both of them had amazing starting rotations. And now, I can't even name you any of the starting pitchers on Atlanta or Houston. Because they only pitch three innings, if that.
We can do a whole episode on this whole opener business that's going on. And baseball, the change that's going on in baseball with these bullpens, you know? Like, you listen to Tony Kornheiser's show, so do I. And the listeners send in songs. Like, did you like that song about Dave Roberts, the manager of the Dodgers, that 27 pitchers for 27 outs? That's what we're getting to, right?
Yes, it's exactly what we're getting to. It's disgusting.
It's not disgusting. It's just, it's a huge change. And I think baseball has a problem because the times of the games, everything they've done to speed up the game, there's all these things that they've done to try to speed up the game, right? Pitch clock, visits to the mound, you know, until you can limit the amount of pitching changes, like that's not going to change. The average time for the World Series games was like close to 4 hours per game.
Yeah, it was awful. It was awful.
Yeah.
Mailbag.
All right, I got listener mail. Great. Lots.
Wow, let's hear it.
I got lots from different places, from different countries, from different social medias, different means. Really fun 2 weeks to get mail about our favorite sports rivalries. Obviously, depending on where you live and what team you follow, that affects what rivalries you like, right? So our friend Matt from British Columbia, from the Nooks and Crannies podcast, messaged me saying Canada versus USA women's hockey. You had that one. Edmonton versus Calgary versus Vancouver. Three-way hatred, he said. Leafs versus all Canadian teams. So, like, you could see what's going on there, right? Like, he's out in Western Canada, and he has obviously a soft spot for the Western teams and also a hatred for the Leafs. And then he threw in Pakistan versus India and cricket.
That's huge.
I know it's huge. Our friend Jesse from the Set Lusting Brews podcast sent me an email. Dallas versus all of the NFC East, which is something that I sort of said when I talked about Eagles Cowboys. You know, like, it depends who you root for. If you're a Giants fan, obviously Giants Cowboys is huge, right? Like, it could be any of those teams. And then, of course, like he told us once before, he went to McNeese State. So he said the big rival of McNeese State was University of Southern Louisiana.
Good he told us, because I wouldn't have guessed that.
He said their fans used to come to the games and they had a terrible chant. It was just USL, go to hell.
I like that. It has a nice ring to it.
They used to chant at the opposing fans. Mark, good friend of the podcast in Philadelphia, he agrees with you on Habs Nordiques. He said, in fact, that's the first rivalry he thought of when he saw the topic. Calgary versus Edmonton, Flyers versus Penguins, Browns versus Ravens. And then there was a lot of talk about, like, because we mentioned who was the Expos rival, right? So he's saying, is it the Expos Nationals? He asked a question, and I'll emphatically say no. That's not a rivalry, you know? So, like, that's...
Well, they've never played each other, so I don't think it officially can be.
Right. And then Derek, friend of the podcast here in the West Island with me, on the Expos rivalries, he said Phillies, Pirates, and Braves. That's who he would consider the best rivals. And we got a response on Twitter from our friend Mitch, who you know in Toronto. I went to summer camp with him, actually. And he said maybe lately the rivalry is Habs Hurricanes. So that's sort of tongue-in-cheek, but
that's true.
A little bit of truth. Yeah, a little bit of truth.
I don't know. I don't think the Hurricanes have lost a game yet this year.
I'm not sure. I mean, with the way the Canadians are going, it's like I'm quickly losing interest in hockey. Jeff in California messaged us on Facebook saying, fun episode and thanks for the recommendation. He's loving the show Only Murders in the Building, which I recommended. So I'm glad he's liking that, which is great.
And what platform is that one on?
In Canada, Disney Plus, but in the US, Hulu.
Okay.
Yeah.
Great. That's a lot of good mail. I noticed we didn't get any mail from my friend Pierre, probably because it was a sports category. So maybe with today's topic being Pearl Jam songs, I think Pierre may chime in.
Right. Okay. Sure. So Pearl Jam. Why'd you pick Pearl Jam as the topic?
Well, because they have a lot of amazing songs. So, you know, there are a lot of good bands out there that I really like. But getting seven good songs, I'm not saying it's hard to find seven good songs from a band that I like, but they might just have seven good songs. Whereas Pearl Jam, you know, when I made my shortlist, it was 14 songs and I had to cut it in half.
Yeah.
And I could have probably, I could have probably made it even longer if I wanted to. So there's a lot to choose from with Pearl Jam, similar to when we did the Beatles. I mean, I'm obviously not going to compare anyone to the Beatles, but you know what I'm saying.
Yeah, yeah, no. I mean, Pearl Jam has an extensive catalog. I mean, amazingly, like, they don't have as many albums as they should, considering how long they've been around.
I noticed that yesterday, actually.
That's kind of by choice. Like, I've been reading up a lot about the Pearl Jam history this week and everything. It's kind of by choice. Like, they kind of made a choice to, like, just be a live band at one point, you know, and just go and tour. So there's a million live albums.
Quality over quantity.
Yes, of course. Yeah. So it's interesting because, like, we'll give the listeners a little bit behind the scenes. So, like, usually, like, around a week before we're going to record, like, we decide on the topic. So in this case, you texted me, do you want to do Pearl Jam? I said, yeah, that's great. And then during the week, I start to do my research, right? Which research basically consists of listening to music. So I basically listened to Pearl Jam the entire week. And I love when we do music because I really dive into, like, an artist, right? Like, when we did Weezer, I just listened to Weezer for the whole week. And I was like, wow, I remember. Like, it's not necessarily something that I listen to regularly. Like, if it comes up on my playlist, I listen to it. But it's not like I'm deep diving into Weezer. So this week with Pearl Jam, I just listened to them all week. And it was, like, my most difficult list in a long time. You know, like you said, like, I had a short list of, like, many songs, much more than seven, and then I got it down to seven pretty quick. And then as I was listening to songs during the week, I was like, no, this song has to be in the top seven. So then I had to remove one. And then I got to another song, I was like, no, this song definitely has to be in the top seven. So now I have to remove another one. And then, you know, songs went in and out of my top seven, and over the course of the whole week, including right up till this morning, and also positions changed within the top seven right up to this morning. So I'm pretty confident in my list, but, like, I feel bad for a couple of songs that kind of didn't make it.
Well, you know, you have until puck drop to make your lineup changes, so it's fine.
I think we pretty much are dropping the puck right now. Right. So, yeah.
So here's one quick Pearl Jam story that I've told before on the show, and I know that you know this. You know, the band was originally supposed to be called Mookie Blaylock, named after a professional basketball player.
I had that written down right here. Right. And, you know, it's funny enough, Mookie Blaylock was jersey number 10. So there's a lot of speculation that that's why the first album is called 10.
And by the way, Mookie was fine with it, actually. He was okay with them naming the band that way. But apparently the lawyers didn't like it. So, you know.
I mean, I listened to another podcast this week, which was just about sort of the history of how the band started. I don't know if you're aware. So there's a lot of urban legend about it and different stories. So the truth has been exaggerated over the years. But basically, the other members of the band were all in Seattle, and they were kind of already in other bands, you know, famously like Mother Love Bone. Like, there was this whole scene, music scene in Seattle, where they were trying to get a band together. And the singer of their original band actually died of an overdose, and then they took a break, and then they were looking for a new lead singer. And I believe it was, like, another musician, maybe someone from the Red Hot Chili Peppers, I forget because I listened to a bunch of stuff this week, that said, hey, I know this guy out in California. Like, maybe he could, like, he's interested, and maybe there's a connection there. So they sent him this, like, cassette of, like, five songs. They sent Eddie Vedder, who was the guy in California, this cassette of five songs, of rough songs. And apparently he just, like, went surfing and then rewrote all the songs and then flew to Seattle and they met for the first time and then Pearl Jam was formed, you know? Like, that's sort of like the mythology of Pearl Jam, but who knows how much truth there's there.
I believe it.
So, Pearl Jam, let's talk about, like, your list. I guess you go first, yeah?
Number 7.
I'm going to start off with a song from the album 10, which was released in 1991. And by the way, that album actually has 11 songs on it, so maybe they should have called it 11, but the song is Black. I don't really have much to say about the song other than I really like it. And you know that I really like it because there were 7 other songs that I bumped off the list in order to include Black on my list.
It's one of the most beloved Pearl Jam songs. It is in my list. I'm going to talk about it in a little bit. Yeah, it's definitely worthy of being in any list of Pearl Jam top 7 songs. 100%. So number 7 for me is the song Rearview Mirror. That's from the 1993 album Versus. This is one of the songs that I told you, like, as I was listening to music during the week, I was like, no, this has to be in my list. Like, this has to be in my list. And then at one point I was like, I don't know. Like, I'm not so sure. So, you know, Versus was the follow-up to 10, basically, right? And it was a huge commercial success. So much so that, like, Pearl Jam was uncomfortable with the success that they were having. Like, they didn't want to be this successful. They were, like, just uncomfortable with the whole thing. Anyways, like, Rearview Mirror is just, it represents sort of everything that Pearl Jam is. It's, like, power, Eddie Vedder's vocals, him screaming, once you're in my rearview mirror. Like, he's just screaming. Like, it's a real powerful, rocking, angry song, I guess.
Good choice. And actually, I could have easily put 3 songs from that album on my list. And Rearview Mirror was one of the ones I considered, but it didn't make the cut. So, but it is a good choice.
Versus is an extremely strong album. Like, this is going to be the only song from Versus that's made it into my list, just for a spoiler. But it's a very, very strong album. And also, by the way, they named their greatest hits album Rearview Mirror, by the way. Also.
Yes, I did notice that.
Number 6.
So next for me is from their self-titled album from 2006. And it's called Worldwide Suicide, which is a really great song. I think it's a somewhat underrated song, to be honest. I don't know. I don't hear too many people talking about it. We did an episode with our favorite album covers. Had I known what the album cover was, I might have included this because the album cover is basically an avocado cut in half with the pit still inside. That's the entire cover. It's pretty funny, actually.
It's funny because I don't really... So it's from 2006. I really didn't pay much attention to Pearl Jam once we hit, like, you know, the last... Once we hit 2000, the 2000s or... Especially 2006, but I'm glad it made your list.
It's the newest song on my list.
Yeah. So number 6 is the other song for me that as I listened to it over during the week, I was like, I just have to include this. And I felt bad for the songs that got bumped, but I had to. And that's the song Given to Fly. That's from the Yield album from 1997. Now, I prefer, look, Pearl Jam has 17 million live albums. Like, when you're not on Spotify or Apple Music, but, like, when you go on Apple Music and you look at live albums, there's like 30. Because they basically just release concert albums. The bands is, like, they just release complete concerts, you know, like, And there's tons of them. But they had like an official live album originally, which was called Live on Two Legs. And the version from Given to Fly from that is rare, really, really great. This is 97. So, you know, this is coming off the success of like their basically their first like three albums, which are huge. And then this song is like I said, Riri Mir is really like loud and angry. Given to Fly is like, I wrote a little poem. A little jingle. Less chaotic, more melodic.
Look at you. Nicely done.
Number 5.
So next for me is the song called Hail Hail from the album No Code, which was released in 1996. I think that this is also a somewhat underrated song because I don't hear many people talking about it. The album cover has 25 different small images, like a checkerboard, I guess you would say. And it seems like these images have absolutely nothing to do with each other, although they probably do, and I'm just not aware of it.
Or maybe they don't. Who knows?
Or maybe
they don't. Really good song. That's a really good song. I completely, really forgot about it, actually. That's a really underrated Pearl Jam song, by the way. Yeah. Number 5 for me. I don't know if this made your list, Josh. It's funny. We always have different... I'm always so worried that our lists are going to be the same and then they end up being different. It's just amazing. Number 5 is the song Yellow Ledbetter. Is that on your list?
It's not on mine.
So, I don't know. You know this song? Yeah.
Of course,
you know,
yes.
Right? Yeah. So, you know, I researched it. It's like it was originally written to be included on the album 10, like on their first album, and they decided against it. And eventually it ended up like on a B-side. At that time, there were still singles. So it was on the B-side of Jeremy. And then it got, people knew it. Like it got popular on college radio and rock radio. And it got so, it's so known by Pearl Jam fans that it actually made it onto their greatest hits album, even though it was never really on an album. Like it never really got really officially released other than on that greatest hits album or on the B-side of Jeremy. It's a beautiful song. Also, like I mentioned about Given to Fly, it's a much more melodic song. As soon as you hear like the guitar at the beginning, it's like, and I read an interview. I read a little interview this week from the guitarist Stone Gossard. He fully acknowledges that he ripped off Stevie Ray Vaughan on the intro. Like that's the sound, and it's like he acknowledges like it's the same as it's a Stevie Ray Vaughan sound. And also a little tidbit about Yellow Ledbetter. It's the outro of the Bill Simmons podcast. He always ends the podcast by playing this song. And by the way, he always starts the podcast with Corduroy, another Pearl Jam song. And he even says, like, Bill Simmons, I haven't listened to his podcast for a couple of years, but he always, like, he comes on and he says, today we're going to talk about Yankees, Red Sox, blah, blah, blah. He tells you, like, what the episode's going to be about. And then he's like, but first, Pearl Jam. And then he plays Corduroy.
I wonder if he has to pay royalties every time he does that.
No, I think he's friends with Eddie Vedder. Eddie Vedder is a huge sports fan, right? Like, so I think he's friends with him. And at one point, they just like made this like deal, like or an agreement that he can use the music because he uses both songs on every episode.
Number 4.
Well, since you mentioned Corduroy, that's the next song on my list. It's from the album Vitology. And by the way, this is the only album where I have more than one song on my list.
Nice.
Released in 1994, which to me, that was the year for grunge alternative music, if you ask me.
I think it's a little bit before, don't you?
I mean, it started before, yes. But I mean, 1994 was also, I think, the year that Dookie came out by Green Day, which was one of my favorite albums. So now this came out in December of 94, so the end of the year, actually 5 days after my birthday, funny enough. And this album actually also was one of my favorite album covers in our episode when we talked about that.
Corduroy is one of the songs that got bumped off my list. It's in my honorable mention. It was originally in the top seven and didn't make it. I like the live versions of Corduroy way better than the Vitology version. It's really powerful. Like, it's a really powerful song. And you know me, like, I like these. Pearl Jam are the masters of, like, the slow buildup of, like, an intro of a song. Like, they just have a great knack for, like, having this super build up to an explosive part, and Corduroy certainly applies because the beginning is of the opening of the song is just tremendous. Yeah, great pick, Josh. I mean, look, I told you I wanted to put it, but I didn't. So, number four for me, you talked about it. It's from the album 10, and that's the song Black. Black is like Pearl Jam fans. It's, I mean, it's on everybody's list. Like I said, like, this song is a must for Pearl Jam fans if you're making a list of best songs. You know, I learned this week, so like 10 was such a commercial success that Sony Records was, they asked Pearl Jam to release Black as a single, and they refused. So they had a pretty big like clash with their own record company, and they just said, we're not releasing it. The song's too personal, and they didn't. Eventually it's still like, sort of like Yellow Ledbetter, it still like managed to get out there on radio and people played it and it got known, and you know, you could hear Black on the radio even though it wasn't a single. What a song, right? I mean, what a song.
It's a great, like, song. Great choice.
There's like a minute and a half at the end where like the piano, I mean, like there's piano and guitar and Eddie's voice are all blending together. I wrote it down. It's the do 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 part, you know, like it's the whole ending of the song, you know, and like that's really special actually.
Love it.
Number three.
So the next song is my only song from the album Verses. I could have had, you know, three or four songs from Verses, but I picked Daughter because it's by far my favorite song on that album. It was released in 1993. I don't really have much to say about the song other than I really like the song. And you know that I like it because it made it to my top three, which actually was very hard to crack the top three of this list.
Daughter didn't make it in my list. I do like it. I'm nothing bad to say about the song. Just couldn't crack the list. It was a huge hit. I mean, Daughter was big. Daughter was like the song that like non-Pearl Jam fans could hear on the radio. It's like, oh, I really like that song, you know, because it was softer, right? You know, I mean, it, as soft as Pearl Jam can get. I mean, Pearl Jam can never really get soft because Eddie Vedder's voice doesn't lend to that. But yeah, good choice. Three for me is Even Flow from the album 10. Now, this was the second single from 10. It was also a huge, huge hit. And like I told you, like Pearl Jam are the masters of like the slow build. Like this song, it does not apply to the there's no slow build at the beginning of the song, but the middle of the song or middle ending, it kind of quietens down, like it gets quiet, and then you just have this bass that kicks in, and it's just like this rolling bass guitar. I don't know what you call it, you know, like it just segment of the song. And you remember the music video? Like, I know you know the video, right?
Actually, I don't remember. You have to remind me.
So in the video, exactly at that part where it kind of quiets down and the bass kicks in, Eddie Vedder is like, it's a concert video. It's a live in concert. And Eddie Vedder is like climbing the wall of the theater up to the balcony. And then he gets to the balcony and then he jumps off into the crowd and they all catch him. It's quite spectacular. So that the video actually was a big part of like the mythology of Pearl Jam and like how great they were in concert. And when you see Eddie Vedder jumping off a balcony into the crowd, you know, so.
One thing I didn't do in my research, I didn't watch any of the videos for any of the songs on my list. So
Pearl Jam has like a little bit of a checkered history when it comes to music videos, because obviously at the time, like in the early 90s, the record companies were pushing for videos. And then a lot of the videos were concert footage and stuff like that. And then I don't think they liked making the videos. Like, I don't think they wanted to. And I think, in fact, I think I read that, like, when they made the video for Jeremy, which was obviously, like, a much more, I don't want to say personal, but, like, a little bit intense song about, like, a school shooting, you know? Like, they just weren't comfortable making videos anymore, you know? They didn't want to do them.
That makes sense.
Yeah.
I think they were also one of the bands that didn't want to deal with Ticketmaster, if I'm not mistaken.
Oh, they sued Ticketmaster, I think.
But unfortunately, you can't have a concert without dealing with Ticketmaster. It's virtually impossible.
There are some artists who've tried, and there's ways around it if you're willing to do it. But yeah, you're right.
Number two.
So next for me is from the album Yield. You mentioned it earlier, released in February of 1998, and it's the song Wishlist. So it's the last song on the album, which is rare that the last song on any album becomes a hit or becomes popular. Usually they just sort of like, yeah, we'll add this song to the album and we'll see what happens.
Or it's a song that's like really personal to the artist that they include on the album. That I don't think really anybody's ever going to get any like popular airplay. Right. But it's like, oh, we're putting this on our album. Yeah, exactly.
But this one, by far my favorite song on this album. The album cover, it's basically a picture of an empty highway, no cars, no people, nothing, and all you see is a Yield sign. The album's called Yield, which is funny because, you know, when you see a Yield sign when you're driving, it's because you have to yield to someone else or something else, but this is just a straight one-lane highway. There's nothing to yield to, so it's pretty funny. Right.
Maybe that's what they're saying.
Yeah.
Don't have to.
Yeah.
Good pick. So I'm at my number two. Oh my God, we're going through this really fast. Number two, Josh, from Vitalogy. You know I told you I like the slow buildups. This is the most epic slow buildups of all Pearl Jam slow buildups.
I think I know what you're going to say.
Yeah, that's Better Man. Is that what you were thinking?
I was thinking that, yes.
The song starts, you know, basically Eddie with maybe one guitar sing sort of quietly. He sings the whole first verse, and then it gets into the second verse. And then the second verse starts off the same way, but it slowly, slowly builds up until the drums kick in, and then eventually the guitar, and then it turns into like this super rockin' song. You know, it was supposed to be on Versus, this song, and they didn't include it because they thought it was going to be too commercial. They didn't want to have a big hit.
I didn't know that. That's an interesting story.
So you remember the 1995 NCAA championship game in Seattle?
Vaguely.
That's the year UCLA won. What was their point guard they had O'Bannon and
Tyus Edney?
Their little point. Tyus Edney, you know, he ran up the court and made that miracle shot in like the Sweet 16.
Yeah, I remember that.
Anyway, so for the final game, because it was Seattle and the whole grunge thing was going on, CBS used Better Man as the opening song to the telecast. I remember it very well.
I think I have that opening on a VHS tape somewhere.
It's wild. I mean, every time I hear Better Man, in the back of my mind, I'm like, yeah, that's when UCLA won the title.
Number one.
Funny enough, my number one song is Better Man, so it's a nice segue. And so this is the second song that I've had on my list from that same album, Vitology. You've said everything that really you could say about the song. Talk about a slow build. This is the song that has a slow build. It's just a great song.
Yeah.
And
it's fantastic.
One little fun fact about this song. So the first time they ever played this song live was at a venue in San Francisco called Slim's Cafe. Now, I've never been to Slim's Cafe. I don't know if it's a small little tiny venue or maybe it's a huge venue. I have no idea. But I do like the name Slim's Cafe. And now, if I ever go back to San Francisco, I'm going to want to check out this place. If it still exists.
Yeah, if it still exists. I was going to say, if it still exists. So my number one didn't make it into your top seven.
What's your number one?
Number one is the first song that I ever heard by Pearl Jam. It blew me away at the time. And it's still number one now. And that's Alive.
So it was on my list of 14, but it didn't make it into the top seven.
I mean, like I said, that this is the first song that most people ever heard of. Well, I mean, I want to say most people because it depends what you listen to, kind of radio you listen to back in the early 90s. But like, I remember like hearing Alive on the radio and I was like, what is this? Like, what is this? You know, who are these guys? And then it played for a long time on the radio until the album was released. And then, of course, I got the album and then it was blown away again. But I mean, Alive, like I said, it's the first song I ever heard by them and it's still my favorite. And it represents everything that Pearl Jam is, which is just power and emotion. Like, it's just like organized chaos in a song, you know? Yeah.
Very graphic descriptions from you today. I like that.
Yeah. Well, when I have time to do a lot of research, I get the feel for it, you know? So there were two honorable mentions that I wanted to mention that were close to my list. One is Corduroy, which I already mentioned, and it was on your list. And the other was State of Love and Trust, which was on the soundtrack of Singles.
Yeah.
When I first made my top seven, I was like, oh, State of Love and Trust, bang, right in there, right? But then it couldn't hold on to its to its spot as the week went on.
That song is actually only on one Pearl Jam album, and it's their greatest hits album.
Well, yeah, exactly. I mean, and the soundtrack of Singles. But yeah, right. That's not a Pearl Jam album.
Right.
Right. Right. And then also, I would be remiss if I didn't mention a couple of other songs. Well, one other song, actually. And that's the song Hunger Strike. But it's not really by Pearl Jam.
Right.
It's by Temple of the Dog, which was a kind of Seattle supergroup with many members of Pearl Jam, including Eddie Vedder, who kind of sings a duet on this song. Like, there's two singers on Temple of the Dog. One is Chris Cornell and the other is Eddie Vedder. And when I read up about Pearl Jam this week, people were saying that, like, recording the Temple of the Dog album was like Eddie's, like, audition, sort of, to be in Pearl Jam. Like, once they saw how this music came out, the other members were like, okay, this guy's our singer now, you know?
I think they made a good choice.
Yeah, for sure.
The Skip and Josh podcast is available wherever you listen to podcasts. If you listen to the show through Apple Podcasts, please leave a review. To interact with the show, send an email to skipandjoshshow@gmail.com. Follow the show on Twitter and go to Facebook to like the show page. And now for some final thoughts from the guys.
You have anything you want to finish the show with? I got a whole bunch of little things I could do.
Go ahead. I don't really have anything today.
I've got so many things, but I don't know where to start, you know? So I know you don't watch football. You said you haven't been watching any football this year.
I did watch about 1 minute of football this week. So now I guess my streak is over.
But you must be aware of what's going on Monday Night Football with the Peyton and Eli Manning version of the telecast.
It's funny you mentioned that because I actually had this on my notes to talk about. I did watch a minute of Peyton and Eli.
Yeah.
It was the last minute of not this week's game, but it was the last minute of one of the games that they did.
Yeah.
And I didn't really get to watch enough of it to be able to comment on it, whether I like it or not. So, yeah.
I mean, look, if I'm really invested in watching the game, if the Eagles are playing on Monday night, I'm probably not going to watch it. If I'm really interested in what's going on in the game, I'm probably not going to watch the Manning version. I'm going to watch the regular version. But just like as a casual watch, it's really quite brilliant, you know? And people are going to say that, like, Eli is just this big doofus and Peyton is like actually the one who's funny and knowledgeable, but it's a little bit of both. Like, Eli is like a perfect little straight man, you know, for his brother. Like, it's really, you gotta really watch it, like, to appreciate it. I would recommend for everybody who watches Monday Night Football to just look on your guide. Like, I mean, here in Canada, one of the TSNs carries the Manning version every week and it's really, really quite brilliant. So I would recommend it. So.
Actually, for someone like me, it's probably more interesting than the regular broadcast because I don't really care about the regular broadcast. I don't care about either team.
Yeah.
So at least this might be a little bit more interesting.
I mean, a lot of times they're just doing like the Tony Romo type of shtick where they're saying, oh, here I would do this or here I would call this and this is what you should do. Like very, very X's and O type of stuff, like high level, like, oh, I'm the quarterback. I know what's going on type of stuff, you know. But other than that, they're just like pretty funny. Like they're really funny, these two, especially it's really great. It's kind of surprising to watch because you think it's going to be stupid, but it's not. It's really quite entertaining. So, and I want to shout out a couple of TV shows, Josh.
Okay.
So one of my favorite shows of the past couple years is a show on HBO. And in Canada, I hear it's on Crave. And that's Selena and Chef. So it's Selena Gomez learning how to cook.
I've seen this in my guide. I don't get that channel, so I've never watched it, but I've seen it in the guide.
I've talked about this before, like last year when I watched it. So it's on season 3 now, like, believe it or not. I mean, there's only like 10 episodes or 8 in a season, but so season 3 is available now on Crave. I think there's 6 episodes out. And, like, it's just the most charming show. And if you like cooking shows, like, it's a must for everybody. I love it. Like, I want to watch it. Like, it's the first thing I want to watch. And
does your daughter like the show?
She loves it. Yeah, she really loves it. Yeah, it's really funny and just very charming, you know. And I like cooking shows. So they have very famous chefs with her teaching her what to do. So it's great. And then the other shout out to TV, you know, we talk about all these new shows. We talk about streaming, Netflix, Crave, HBO, Amazon Prime, Disney, all this stuff. And I just want to shout out to like one of the original, like the OG, you know, as the kids say, Josh, the OG. That's Survivor. Like I'm watching Survivor this season. Matthew is the one that told me like we should watch Survivor and I'm watching it. And Survivor is still, it's so great. It's so, so great. Like, it's really like, after all these years, it's still just really, really good. It's fun to watch. And I watched the most recent episode yesterday and I was like, wow, this is really great. So
I don't think I've watched that show since season 3.
Right. Okay. I mean, it's still the same premise. Not much has changed. It's just still really good. It holds up, as they say, you know?
One thing I'll say about television in general, there are a few shows that I watch like on ABC or NBC or whatever.
Yeah.
But in the past year and a half is when I only discovered, you know, Netflix and all these other streaming services.
Yeah.
Now that I've watched shows on Netflix and HBO and Amazon, I can't watch regular television shows on NBC or ABC anymore because they just seem so fake.
Yeah. Yeah. Like a sitcom, like, and I like the Goldbergs a lot and I watch it, you know, but it's such an old formula, right? Like, it's such an old style of television, like a situation comedy or even like a, 1 hour drama. Like, it's just.
Yeah. Because on network television, they can't have dialogue that sounds real, you know, because in real life people swear and on network television, you can't.
Right. So what are you watching now? I thought you told me you wanted to recommend some shows.
Well, I recommended Once Upon a Time in Queens. Other shows that I'm watching. In fact, I finished watching The Affair, 5 seasons. That's on Crave.
5 seasons. That's a big time commitment.
It is. But it actually went pretty quick. It's a good show. I mean, season 3 I didn't care for, but the others were good.
Mm-hmm.
A Canadian show that was only, I think, 8 or 10 episodes called Moonshine on CBC.
Wow.
So I finished watching it already. It's pretty quick. It's only 8 or 10 episodes.
Mm-hmm.
An HBO show, actually a documentary, and this is old, but I only got to watch it recently, called McMillions, which is about the whole Monopoly scam.
At McDonald's.
So actually, McMillions. McDonald's
Monopoly, like how they...
So... McMillions is 6 episodes. Really, it should have just been 4 episodes or maybe even 3 episodes. They really dragged it way too long.
But or just one
documentary. I got annoyed. Watching episode 3 and 4, I got annoyed already. Like, let's just get on with this already. So
get on with this and tell me what happened, right?
Exactly. Like, they over-dramatized it.
Right, okay.
And another show, which just came out with a new season, I think a week or two ago, Curb Your Enthusiasm. Okay. So I'm now up to date on Curb Your Enthusiasm.
You watched all the old Curbs.
Oh, I watched all the old ones years ago.
Oh, okay.
But I just watched the last season and a half, let's say, last week.
Oh, wow.
And, you know, it's the same thing every episode. So it gets kind of annoying after a while. Luckily, there's only 10 episodes every season. But there are, in each episode, there's like 1 or 2 really funny lines that might remind you of Seinfeld, or might not, but for those 1 or 2 lines per episode, it's worth watching.
Yeah, no, it's, I mean, this is the kind of show that I haven't watched all the episodes of Curb, but I've watched many, like, over the years, just here and there, on airplanes, as I catch up on them when I have a flight a lot of times, you know, and like you said, not every one is brilliant, but in every one, there's something brilliant, you know?
Right, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Exactly.
Very good. All right. So now I'm in the hot seat for next episode. I'm going to have to come up with a topic.
You don't have to tell me now.
No, I won't. So enjoy your tennis today, and I'll speak to you next time.
Great.